Welcome back to The Shtick. We're in the studio with a young man called Zevi Slavin. Hi, Zevi. Welcome to The Shtick.
Pleasure to be here.
It's a very special day today. We're testing out the new lights.
They look gorgeous.
And
slightly blinding, but beautiful.
And we're talking about enlightenment.
Right, that's very apropos.
Yeah, I think so, because you're a philosopher and a scholar, and you go really deep into the mystic.
I like what you did there. That was clever.
Thank you. So what's your shtick?
My shtick is the deep-seated belief that at the core of religion lies mysticism, at the core of all religion. And at the core of mysticism lies a sense of unity, a feeling of unity, that's expressed in a dimensional sense, that the illusion of separation and distance is just that, it's an illusion. It's expressed in a temporal sense, that the illusion of past and future is really just expressions of the present, which is eternal, the eternal now, as it's often phrased in the West. And that the distinctions and separations between us, one another, us and them, me and myself, internally, these are all false dichotomies and false distinctions. And when we come to appreciate this unity, this unison and deep-seated union of all of reality, it brings us to the healthiest possible state of existence, both interpersonally, personally, globally, communally. And that's the message. That's my shtick, Henry. What's your shtick?
We've just seen a little, well, I've got lots of shticks, but we've just seen an excerpt from Greg Sheridan's book, Launch. It was a Jewish launch, because his book was launched by Malcolm Turnbull. But his book, which I'm holding now, I didn't hold it up in the first segment, it says, God is good for you. Now, how do you relate that? Because you've got a whole shtick on the New Testament, which I'd like to go straight into, because that's right. What you're studying at the moment.
Right, so this is a Christian book,
Well, it's universal in a sense, but he doesn't mention Islam in this.
Right. So I haven't read the book yet, I'll be very honest. But I have to agree with the sentiment that God is good for you. God could also be bad for you, and it depends on what conceptualization of God you have.
Exactly.
And if you have a healthy one that brings people together, that brings you together, that brings you together with others, then that's going to be a healthy conception of the divine, and one which we should strive for. My shtick in the New Testament, which is what I was studying in an academic sense before I got into this comparative or global mysticism, was looking at the New Testament within its Jewish context. So the New Testament today, very clearly, is a Christian book. It is the canonical work of Christianity upon which its theology and philosophy is based. And that's not going to change very soon. But the inception and the authorship of the New Testament was written in a Jewish context, written predominantly by Jews, for Jews, about Jewish concepts. The idea of Messiah is a Jewish concept. Right. Now, Christianity and the New Testament obviously went very, very far and separated from Judaism, and that's undeniable. And part of that separation was a very painful and very bloody one, unfortunately. So it's very hard to speak about Christianity or the New Testament objectively, because when we begin to talk about Christianity, we conjure very horrific memories. But what I was trying to do was to look past the pain and look past the bloodshed, to go to the text itself from an academic historical perspective in its original context, and examine the way that the New Testament quotes the what is called by Christians the Old Testament, what is known more accurately as in academia as the Hebrew Bible, or the Tanakh, as we refer to it. The way that the Tanakh is quoted in the New Testament, particularly in the Gospels, particularly in the Gospel of Matthew, because it's the most Jewish of the Gospels, and looking at the hermeneutics of Matthew in comparison to three other bodies of literature composed in roughly the same period, known as the Second Temple literature, which situates us between the end of the biblical canon, Zechariah, Haggai, Malachi, and before the opening of the rabbinic canon with Masechtas Brachos and the Mishnah, which then expands to the Talmud, and etc., etc. The other texts in the period are the precursors of the Mishnaic text, which is the early Midrashim, what we can call the proto-rabbinic texts. We have the text from Josephus, the historian of the period. We have texts from Quamran, the Dead Sea Scrolls, which include biblical texts and sectarian texts.
Mm.
And we have the New Testament texts as well. And looking at the way that these four texts interact similarly or differently with the Old Testament, with the Tanakh, proves for a very interesting study with some very fascinating results.
I don't know what to say to that, because it's way too, academic in a sense. Yeah. It's a very academic approach.
Let me break it down. Let me try and make it simple. There's been an ongoing Jewish-Christian debate, a biblical theological debate, arguing over certain theological premises, over certain identities, and the intention of my writing is to look at the debate from a very different perspective in a way that the debate doesn't begin at all. And very simply, most of us know that the way that a Jew reads a text classically is in a multifaceted reading. There are different layers and levels to the text. The way that we generally read any book, if we're approaching the West, is that there's one straightforward, simple meaning of the text. And when we approach the New Testament as a Western book, reading Tanakh at one level, that then allows for debate, because there's only one reading of the text, so either I have the right reading or you have the right reading. But if we read it as a Jewish text, reading the text Jewishly at a multifaceted level, then we can appreciate that perhaps it is not reading the Tanakh at a literal, straightforward level, but it's reading it at a poetic or an allegorical level. And it's by finding those literary styles and devices in its context and then identifying in the New Testament, we can put the Jewish-Christian debate to rest. Mm. Because we can appreciate that both are being approached from different perspectives where they're really not at all clashing with one another, but just discussing the text at different levels. Does that make some more sense?
No.
No.
No, I don't think our viewers really even understand. Because I just wanted to bring you in because you've just come into my life in the last week. I filmed you at Spiritgrow where you actually work.
Yes,
correct. Right? You work there as an intern?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
A resident scholar.
Resident scholar. It's fantastic. Yeah. And you were doing a presentation on gematria.
That's right.
Which is another aspect. This is the Jewish mysticism on Kabbalah.
Yes.
And but I would like to invite you back on the show to do an entire show because you've got so much shtick. It's just ridiculous.
My pleasure. I'd love to be back.
Zevi Slavin, it's been really great to have you on the show. And we're going out now with a little bit of music that we started the segment with from Trevor Hall. Mm. Who is someone you suggested. Mm. It's beautiful music. Mm. Absolutely beautiful.
Top notch.
And we'll be back next week with more shtick because it just never, ever ends. And there's a way, there's a way, there's a way, there's a way, there's a way.
Always, always, and it has.